Oh, well, you don't have to do that in front of us, but.
We're working on that. I should introduce, Shane Olson introduced himself earlier, but Shane just joined the company right around the first of the year and really is kind of the direct interface with local public safety here in Minnesota. And we'll be doing a lot of that, those signups here in the weeks and months ahead and years ahead, so we're very happy to have been part of the team.
And I would just say, I was out at my water patrol offices on the beautiful shores of Lake, go out there very often in the winter. Yeah, he walked in, oh, nice to see you again, come on in, you run over the joint. I'm like, she's like, well, who are you? And then I asked him, what are you doing here and who are you? And he told me, here on behalf of AT&amp;T doing this thing, on behalf of FirstNet.
Right.
And I think it's great, so it's moving.
And we want to be, Ann Tracy is here from, do you want to introduce yourself? And you are live blogging this, so I think that's important to know, yeah.
So, Madam Chair, before I get started, if I use slides, can you see them? Are they behind you?
Yeah, they're right behind you.
Oh, I'm gonna move in for a second. I'm gonna move over here.
And we can see them pretty well.
All right, plus I'll be right by the phone, so you guys are on the phone, right?
They're probably on mute.
We're here.
They're really good about going on mute, so we don't hear.
Yeah, I'll put them back on mute.
But not us.
So, my name's Rich Stanek, I'm the sheriff in Hennepin County, just on the other side. Cal and I had to get a passport to get over here, but we're gonna go. It's been my pleasure over the last 3 years, and I got reappointed here recently to serve on the FirstNet Board of Directors. So I am not the techie guy. I serve on the policy board overseeing the implementation of FirstNet nationwide. Having said that, long before there was a FirstNet, there were a number of coalitions of first responders across this country that came together working very hard. And I was one of those folks way back then, had no vision or you know, dibs on coming into the FirstNet board. It was actually by accident. And if you look at, what do I gotta do this way?
Yeah.
Down. No, up.
You might want to count this.
Did it move? No.
No.
Down.
There we go.
No. Wait a
minute.
Look
at you.
Down doesn't move it forward. Down moves it backwards.
Weird.
A sign of things to come. My background's easy, right? I've been a cop for 35 years now. I'm a Minneapolis police officer. I leave to serve as our elected sheriff. As you see, and then I had a chance to serve in the legislature with Margaret and a number of others as I go on home week with Vic and Andy and others in the room. I've worked with Paul over the years.
You should say you're a House member, not just
I'm a House member, right. Right, I'm a House member. I love the public policy, I hated the politics. So here we are.
That's not politics, that's just tribal.
That's right. All right. Here's the FirstNet Board of Directors, right? So you should get an idea. The FirstNet Board changed over here fairly recently. We added three new individuals, and myself got reappointed. But we lost a couple people who were key in terms of where they took. And FirstNet members are appointed to three-year terms. Not so much the federal ones. There's three federal appointments representing the Department of Homeland Security, Department of Justice, and OMB, which I have no idea what they are, but they got a lot of dang money and power and influence. Those three are fairly, they change over all the time, but the rest of us are fairly consistent. There are four from the public safety sector. I'm going to talk about the four of us in a minute. And then there are eight or so from the private sector. And, you know, the one thing I've learned coming into this is that was really important because they come from all perspectives, both large carriers, small carriers, rural carriers, the private business sector, which has been a good mix because as a cop, I am not the guy to put together a nationwide broadband network, but I can tell them what I need in that nationwide broadband network, and then our friends on the board, you know, have influence in terms of helping to get that part done.
So is this the reappointed board, or is this the old board?
No, this is an appointed board, and this is the new board in place now, right? This board was finalized here just in the last couple of weeks. But we lost, like, Governor Jim Douglas, who had a strong influence. He headed up the finance committee, right? And to replace him was, you know, was a little bit of a struggle. Jim did a nice job for the FirstNet Board of Directors with his influence and his knowledge base coming out of being a retired governor. But, you know, having said that, every time we replace somebody, it seems to go up a notch or two. These are the four public safety members that we see. And myself, I represent sheriffs and law enforcement. Jeff Johnson is the co-chair of the FirstNet board, and he represents firefighters. You've got Commissioner Richard Ross out of the city of Philadelphia, mostly police. And he took Chris Burbank's place, who retired off the board. And then Kevin, who's a paramedic EMS professional. So we tried to cover the four sectors. The four of us work very well, but again, you know, AT&T's job is to build it to, well, certainly during the RFP process, it was to build it to what it is that we're looking for and how we might be using it in practical applications across the country. And I think they've done a very nice job of that. Our journey is pretty simple, as you know, from, you know, the 9/11 attacks, which is really what kind of got this going. There were discussions about this prior to, but then you skip down to the 9/11 commission, the FirstNet, or that enabling language really arose out of that at the end of the day. You jump back up to when FirstNet was created in 2012 in federal legislation. We worked really hard on the outreach piece. The first 3 years I was there, I was traveling across the country meeting with my counterparts. It's hard with 18,000 law enforcement agencies, who knows how many firefighters, to really get that message out and then, you know, help them influence what's happening back in their states, territories, and the district. And then back over to the consultation in all 56 states, the deployment, and now our partnership and plans moving forward. I think that's probably where Corey and Melinda come in. The state of Minnesota has been a great partner in this. But I remember going to a meeting 4 or 5 years ago where public safety wasn't always at the table. And there were a lot of concerns as I traveled the country that this was a state-run operation and that they were cutting out local law enforcement and public safety. That is not the case. We've been at the table. We've been partners with the state of Minnesota and I think other areas across this country as well. The First Responder Network Authority, and then, of course, you talked about the AT&T. If Paul's correct, and he wrote me out a check for $56 billion, or a guarantee of $56 billion over the next 20 or 25 years. That's a lot of money. We went through, I was part of the RFP process, the team, and I spent basically my summer before last, 4 months sequestered, going through these RFPs, looking at what the needs were. AT&T wasn't the only one in town. Together to try and to do this. At the end of the day, though, AT&T had not just the capital, but the interest. They listened to what first responders wanted across this country, and they convinced us that they were the partner to go with. This is probably one of the largest, if not the largest, public-private partnership that the federal government and others have ventured into. And I know what you're going to say, Vic, because you were around for a long time. Those public-private partnerships don't always work out at the end of the day, but I think this one will, because the FirstNet board, our job is to make sure that AT&T is delivering on what it is that first responders need across this country so we can service states like Minnesota and the rest of them. We talked about the opt-in and opt-out, going back 2 years, a lot of speculation, you know, pessimism about who would and who wouldn't. At the end of the day, all 56 states, regions, territories signed on to FirstNet, either because they did so proactively, like Governor Dayton in Minnesota did,